talking about Holy Spirit for the past, I don't know, 5 months, it seems like. But it's been good. I think every service has brought a little bit more clarity to Holy Spirit, who He is, why He is, that He's a person, that He's not a thee, He's not a thing, He's a person, that He has a personality, that He has a life, that he came here to be with us, that He is for every believer. And we've talked about that He has a personality. Amy talked about He's a nurturer. Stephen talked about how He's a revealer. And I wanted to, today I just want to talk about, and last week I think we talked about the baptisms, the three different baptisms. The week before that I spoke, it was about, is He Pentecostal? And, you know, we kind of got into that and found out that, you know, if you think Pentecostal is, it's the religion or it's the what the world thinks about Pentecostalism, then no, He's not Pentecostal. He's not into you know, wearing long dresses all the time, women not wearing makeup, and men having, you know, nicer things than women, and women can't do anything with their life because it's a woman, they're a woman, and you have to wear your hair up in a bun. That's bondage. Okay, I'm going to get you guys with me this morning, man, because you guys got to sleep longer. You should have more energy. Evidently, that is not the truth. Maybe if you get up earlier, you have more. But He's not Pentecostal in that sense. But if you think that He's Pentecostal because the day of Pentecost was the completion of one of the feasts, and He came to empower us to live righteously, to empower us to live with grace in the earth, to do what God calls to do, then yes, He's absolutely Pentecostal today. The message title is, He is the Grace Giver. And we're going to look at a word, and the word is charismatic. Now, if you think back to the 1960s, there was something called a charismatic renewal. It swept the nation. It started actually in an Episcopal church when a guy got up and told the testimony of his Pentecost experience in his life. It shook the church up. And because he started talking about the charismatic nature of Holy Spirit. Now, if you just break it down, and we, you know, is Holy Spirit charismatic? Well, if you think about the denomination or the renewal charismatic, or if you've seen people act weird or act strange and call themselves charismatic, you know, as we've talked about this, I'm sure some people have gone online, or if you go, be careful what you look at online. Just let me tell you that right now, okay? I sift through things really well before I start reading a bunch, because some people are gifted to talk and gifted to write about the wrong thing. Just as much as the anointing of God works for God, Satan anoints as well to work people away from God. And so you have to be cautious about the information you read. And I want to tell you that if it doesn't line up with the Word, throw it out. It has to line up with the Word. Today we're going to see several things about gifts or the charisma of Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is the gift giver. He is the grace gift giver. So charis means grace. That's what the Greek word means. Ma is gift. Charismatic is the gift giver. It's a double declarative about who Holy Spirit is. Okay? So He's the gift giver. Now, as we look at this, we're going to really look in 1 Corinthians 14 today. We're going to look in several scriptures. But what we're going to find out is that Holy Spirit possesses these gifts we're going to look at. We're going to look at 9 altogether. And then we're going to, and I'm not going to take a ton of time with them. I'm going to hit a couple of them more than others. But there are 3 different groups that these gifts lay in. And we'll see it in just a second. But what I want to tell you is if Holy Spirit is a gift giver, He's the one that brings grace to give, then yes, He's charismatic. But He's not. Holy Spirit will never be pinned down to a denomination. Never. And I've been in, you know, I was raised up in charismatic, Pentecostal, Word of Faith. Now, we were never in the Pentecostal UPC church, but I was around that. And, you know, the thing about the enemy is this, that even if you're doing something right, he'll try to get you to hone in on one thing so it becomes wrong. Yeah. For instance, in the Pentecostal church, if you don't have, it's called the initial response doctrine, and they say that the Holy Spirit comes, you're baptized in the Holy Spirit with the infilling of the Holy Spirit and the initial evidence of speaking in tongues. And they say that and we're going to talk about tongues next week, it's going to be awesome, but they say that if you don't speak in tongues, you're not really filled. That's why they bring people down and they tarry and tarry and tarry and tarry. And I'm not talking about tarry. I'm talking about tarry. Like you wait until you get it. And there's some people saying, let go, and some people saying, hold on. And, you know, and it's confusing, and you don't understand it really. But they say if you don't begin to speak in tongues, you're not really filled. Well, I'm going to tell you something. I spoke in tongues when I was 4 years old. I got it. I started doing it. And we said, well, you can do that at 4 years old? Well, heck yeah. You know, I heard Jill and others say, you don't get a junior Holy Spirit just because you're a baby or because you're young. Well, I began to do it. I spoke in tongues a lot. But I acted like a heathen a lot while I was doing it. And there's people that didn't speak in tongues that acted a lot more spirit-filled than I did. They were a lot nicer than I was. But you can get proud about different gifts of the Holy Spirit, thinking they're yours, that nobody else has them. Or if somebody doesn't have what you have, then they're not as good as you are. I want to tell you, there's no bigger lie of the enemy. Because that's not what God's about. He's not about bringing shame. He's about bringing glory. He's about bringing good things. So anyway, in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1, it says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant. Well, isn't that nice of Paul? He doesn't want us to be dumb about this. So in 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14 are some of the biggest chapters on gifts to the body, gifts for the body. But the one gift that's the most important in the body is in chapter 13. Love. Because I don't care what you do, and he says it, you could build homes for the homeless, you could feed the hungry, you could move mountains, you could give your body to be burned, but if you are not in love, it's worthless. Right. We got to learn to walk in love, be love men and women, right? Okay, so, and he says, now concerning. Now, I want to tell you this word, now concerning, it happens six times in 1 Corinthians, and there's a reason for it. And then in 1 Corinthians 5, 9, it says, as I wrote you in my earlier epistle. Listen, the church at Corinth was a jacked up place. It's a lot like the church today, okay? There was a lot of weird things going on in Corinth. Corinth, if you look at it, it was a hub or a port in Greece, and it's where a lot of commerce came through, a lot of merchants came through. And I'll tell you, where a lot of sailors come in, what is there? Love, but not the right kind of love. Okay, you know, it's like Eddie Murphy, nookin' but nubbin' all the wrong. Seriously, nobody? Does anybody remember what I'm talking about? Buckwheat. Yeah. See, that's the kind of thing that happens, and I can't show the first service because I do something stupid like that. But anyway, so they come into port, maybe we can edit that out, looking for love in all the wrong places. Well, they found it, but what happens when sinners get saved? They still act like sinners sometimes. And so when he wrote, he was telling them, now concerning this, he said six times, and then as I wrote in my earlier epistle, this was the second letter to the church in Corinth. He wrote an earlier epistle, but we don't have record of it. We don't have it. So this is actually 2 Corinthians, and 2 Corinthians is actually 3 Corinthians. So he had to write three times about some of the same stuff to the same church, to the same leaders. This should be really helpful to somebody. This was New Testament, revival was breaking out, and they had a bunch of mess going on. But he starts talking to them about Holy Spirit. And he goes on in verse 4 and says, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Now watch as we read this. I think you'll see the Trinity. Diversities of gifts. Gifts means charisma, but the same Spirit. I believe that's Holy Spirit who gives those. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. Ministries, I believe, are the offices that certain people walk in, and Jesus assigns those offices according to Ephesians 4. It says that he assigns apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. He's the one that chooses those. That's why you can never vote in a pastor and be sure he's the one. Wow, that was overwhelming. Must I talk about voting for a minute or two? There is not voting in the New Testament. That's man-made. It's committees. I can't stand committees. Committees hold things up. Committees keep you from getting things done. Like, hey, pull the trigger, man. Let's do it. Even if we're wrong, at least we're moving. You know? And so, anyway, then he says, so Jesus assigns. And then, but it's the same, or then it says, and there are diversities of activities. That word activities actually is energema, which means this, of the results of the energy of God in the believer, the results energized by God's grace. And so there are activities, or there's a diversity of activities, but it's the same God who works in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Everybody say each one. For the profit of all. Now he's going to start talking about some stuff in we'll see later in chapter 14. He starts talking about church services and stuff. But right now he's talking about each individual believer has certain gifts. Now, I want to tell you this. I believe these nine gifts we're about to read are gifts that Holy Spirit owns and he distributes as he sees fit to believers, anyone. Okay. A lot of people say, well, I have the gift of healing, or I have the gift of prophecy, or I have the gift of this, or I have the gift of that. I would say the Holy Spirit has the gift, and he uses you as a conduit of his power. I would not say that he has given the gift to you exclusively, because what it does is it is actually a contradiction of what Jesus did when he left. This is something we've always tried really hard to do in this church, is not become person-focused, or personality-focused. Yeah, I lead the church, Amy, and I started it with James Grundy and Jody and Amber Rowland, but we are not, this is not our church, it's the Lord's church. Jesus is the head of the church. We are the under-shepherds. We're the ones that look out for it. But we've been cautious over the years not to bring a bunch of attention to ourselves. Why? Because it's our job to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. The saints cannot do the work of the ministry without the charisma of Holy Spirit. When Jesus left in John 14, 15, and 16, he said to the guys, now this is supposed to come at the end of the message, but I got to give it right now. He said to them, look guys, I'm about to leave. I'm going to go home and be with the Father. I'm going to sit at the right hand of majesty and wait, because I'm sending another me. When he says, I'm sending another helper, it actually means I'm sending one like me. Well, how could it not be like him? It's the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They're three in one. But Jesus was in the earth. Do you think Jesus, I mean, I don't know how many scriptures it talks about. People met Jesus and thronged him because his fame preceded him. Now, Jesus walked in all the fullness of all the gifts. He was unique. But what he did was show us that we have the ability to walk just like him through the Holy Spirit. However, we may not, one of us, do everything he did, but collectively we'll do greater than he did. Okay? Because, now listen, he told the disciples, don't go out, don't go testify, don't do anything until you get Holy Spirit, until he baptizes you. We looked at that last week. He said, don't go until you get this power. But and then he also said, in one of the scriptures, he said, these things and greater than these things shall you do in my name. Now, there have been things done greater, miraculously, in miracles and healings and stuff than Jesus did. There have been. But they've not all come from one person. It's important that you see this, because each and every one of you can walk in the charisma of Holy Spirit. At any point in time, simply by yielding yourself to be a vessel for him to work through. So when Jesus went to the cross, he said, I got to go, guys, but it's better for you that I go, because another helper will come. In other words, I'm going to multiply myself by billions because he comes, and whereas I could only be in one place at one time, he can be in every believer all the time. Okay? Okay. Now, Then these are the gifts, he said. In verse 8, it says, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. Okay, so there's one. To another, the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healings by the same Spirit. You're going to get in a message here. Four times already he said, the same Spirit. Here's four different gifts, the same Spirit. Then he says, to another, working of miracles. To another, prophecy. One discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing what? To each one individually as he wills. As Holy Spirit wills, he distributes. It's really important that you understand this. Because you can be in a supermarket and see somebody that's sick, and the Holy Spirit can bring on you the gift of healing. See, it's a gift. It's nothing you could earn or you could do. But in order to do what God's called you to in your life, you're going to need the charisma of God to do it. Because if your calling is within your talent, you need a bigger calling. Your calling should never be commensurate with your experience. It should always be bigger than your experience. Because that means you have to rely on something you couldn't earn to get it done. That way you don't get the credit and he does. Okay. And when you see somebody that needs healing, the gift of healing comes upon you. You see somebody that needs a prophetic word, and the gift of prophecy comes upon you to give. But it doesn't mean it stays with you all the time. However, you can be available to it all the time.
That's right.
This is really good stuff. And it dispels some things that we've heard. You know, some people say, well, I've got the gift of prophecy, and I'm the prophet, and I've got the gift of healing, and I'm the healer, and all these things. Yes, you can have that gift distributed to you at the time he sees fit. But if it ever turns into you being the only one that can heal of something specific, you're off the track.
Yeah.
What if I can't, what's your name? Rick, I've got the gift of healing. And he's actually seen people healed and everything. Well, man, I live across the United States and I can't get to him. I'm in trouble. You see, that's why Holy Spirit came. So yeah, Rick can operate in the gift of healing, but somebody over by me can operate in it too. And then when I become educated and informed, I can operate in it. This is discipleship, guys. This is easy stuff. God is equal opportunity. He is the most equal opportunity, non-misogynistic person there is. He believes in women just as much as he believes in men. I can guarantee you that. Okay. So we just went through the offices. So let me tell you about these just real quick. These different gifts, we're going to split into three categories. The first is the discerning gifts. The second is the declarative gifts. And the last one is the dynamic gifts. So three in each category. If you wanted to give them other names, you could say that the discerning gifts were perceiving gifts. Declarative would be proclaiming. And dynamic gifts would be power gifts, okay? Now, just remember, anybody can walk in these as the Spirit chooses to use you in them. But the first step to being used is be willing to be used. That's just really what it boils down to. There's so many Christians that say they're Christians but are unwilling to be used by God to do what he's called them to do because they don't want to risk their dignity. They don't want to risk their reputation. Well, honey, if you're holding on to your reputation more than you are the hand of God, you don't have a reputation. Because your reputation here, as civil and wonderful as it may be, is not going to follow you to heaven. What follows you to heaven is what you've done that's been in your book. Anyway, I get off on something totally different. So the discerning gifts, let me go through them real quickly. First is the word of knowledge. Word of knowledge is this, to know something specific that you didn't learn about through natural means. Okay, so in John 14, 16 through 19, it's the example of Jesus goes to the well, asks the lady for some water. The lady says, well, you know, why are you here? We're Samaritans. You can't hang around us. And Jesus says, you know, most of you know this story. At one point in time, he says, how many husbands, or what do you say? He said, go and get your husband, or something like that. I probably should just read it so I don't butcher this thing. John, is it John 9:29? Is that what I told you? No, John 4:16. Maybe I didn't put it in my thing. Okay, let me just try to butcher it further. He says, no, I'm going to read it. Sometimes you just got to do. I'm trying to save time, but some things don't need to be saved time on. Okay. Verse 13 in John 4, it says this, Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will never thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst, but the water I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up until everlasting life. I want to tell you, I think this is also representative of Holy Spirit because what starts as a little becomes a lot. Everything after Jesus, it only takes a little to get a whole lot. Okay, so then he goes on to say, woman said to him, sir, give me this water, that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. Jesus said to her, go, call your husband, come here. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you have said well, I have no husband, for you've had five husbands, and the one you're with now isn't your husband, and that you spoke truly. And then this is the funniest scripture in the Bible. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive you are a prophet. He just read her book to her, and she clues in. Oh, he may know what he's talking about. This was a word of knowledge. Okay, that was all it was for, it was an example. Okay, the next one is the discerning of spirits. The discerning of spirits is to be made aware of the presence of a demonic spirit for one reason. Get rid of it. Yeah. Don't have a conversation with it. Don't have high tea with it. Don't do anything with it. Just get rid of it. Amen. And some people, you know, they want to find out the name, the background, how many brothers and sisters it has, what color hair it has, and all this, because it somehow must bear weight on what I've got to do in this situation. I used to go on the radio every day when I run pest control and listen to a guy. He always talking about demons, always talking about the demonic realm. You know what? Satan should not be sensationalized. His stupid demons should not be sensationalized and get more billboard time than Jesus. Jesus, you know how he dealt with demons? Get out! Yeah. Only one time he asked a name. And now people build doctrines on having to have the name of every demon that you cast out. I don't know. Maybe they put it in their little notebook. I cast out this one today and this one today and this one. This one was really bad. And he had a bad sister too. But, you know, I don't know why you'd want to keep up with all of it. If all you're having conversations is with demons, I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to people who have been talking to God. I don't know about y'all. So it's discerning of spirits. Now, this is the difference between the discerning of spirits and what some people say is the gift of discernment. Some people say, well, I have the gift of discernment. I can see things in people. I can see in Justin, you know, there's these things going on in his life, and, you know, and he needs to correct these things. No, you have the gift of criticism. You have the gift of just waking up in the morning, being able to point out the bad things in people, and you want to put a holy name on it called the gift of discernment. Horse crap. There is no such thing as a gift of discernment. Don't ever let anybody tell you they walk in it. It's not in the Bible. Not in the Bible. People just say it is. They talk bad about somebody or say they'll say, I've got the gift of discernment. Well, you got the gift of suspicion. I'll give you that. You got the gift of criticism. I used to have the gift of it's not a gift. I was very critical. I'm walking away from that. But I never tried to mask it with something pretty and call it discernment. I was just critical. I mean, just if you are, just say you are. Don't try to mask it and make it holy through God. Well, I've got the word of God on this. This person is dealing with this. No, you've got your word, and you'll answer to your word. So anyway, so throw that out. And Paul did this in Acts 16 by identifying a woman with a demon, and the demon left. That's always the end of the story. When one of the disciples or Jesus got involved with the demon left. Okay, next, word of wisdom. Word of wisdom is a divine answer or solution for a particular event. An example is John 9:29. Jesus healed a blind man. The Pharisees got upset about it, and they start talking to him and saying, well, this was of the devil. And the blind man says, how could this be of the devil? Because the devil would not heal my eyes, but Jesus, the Son of God, healed my eyes. And what happened was he had a word of wisdom about a particular event that further showed the Pharisees this is the Son of God. Whereas before, he didn't have that knowledge. He didn't have that wisdom to point them in a direction. You understand that? Okay, so you see that. All right, the next gifts are the declarative gifts. The first one's prophecy. Prophecy is the message of encouragement from a person to a person or persons. And we see this in 1 Corinthians 14. And one of the scriptures says, I remember a story. This lady got up in church one day, and she starts prophesying from the back. And just going on and on and on. It was the Andrew Womack conference. And Andrew Womack said, ma'am, I need you to sit down. No, I can't sit down. I've got a word of prophecy. Ma'am, I need you to sit down. No, I can't stop it. I can't control it. And so Andrew Womack, he knows the whole Bible. Jealous. You can quote the whole Bible almost. It's crazy. But he goes to the scripture and he says, the spirit of the prophet is under the prophet. Shut up. Be quiet. No, I can't control it. I can't. Well, then I'm going to help you control it. And so ushers went back and helped her find a way to the door. Why? She was causing a disruption, a distraction to get people off what was really going on. Yeah. The spirit of the prophet is under the prophet. It's the same with tongues. Well, I just can't help it. It comes on me and I just start speaking in tongues. Then you are saying Paul was wrong and you're right. Because he said, the truth is, the spirit of the man is under the man.
Yeah.
If that was not true, you would never do anything to transgress the spirit of God.
Yeah.
Well, I just don't sin. I just can't help it. I just don't sin. You see, people don't want to say that. But they want to say, I can't control these things. Why? Because they really just want the spotlight on themselves. We have somebody come up one time, commandeer the stage, take the microphone. I was in a moment. I was in a God moment. I mean, my eyes rolled in the back of my head. I was just there. I was just, you know, some of you feel it sometimes in worship. And all of a sudden, thus saith the Lord, and all this kind of baloney. I got out of my moment real quick. I wanted to go into rush tackle moment. I was tired. I got mad. And then I had to get up and preach. It was a hard day of preaching. I had to walk in forgiveness by faith as I preached. Because I wanted to tell these people to get out. But anyway, it took care of itself. And they left. But that person never got back up and did that. Because we've made it abundantly clear. The people on the stage are in control of the stage. They're the ones leading us. Now if someone has a word or something, they bring it to Tony or Jason or Terry or somebody like that. And the person who's leading the... You know what a prophetic word works in a church service? And we're talking about more of this next week. You bring it to the person leading the service because they're the one God is using to bring the word to the body. And I heard a Pastor Steve up in Convergence tell me one time, and it was so wonderful because I was raised where if you got a prophetic word in church, it was for the whole body. Well, that's not true. It could be just for you. It could be confirmation in you for what you're about to hear that it was really for you today. Or it could be for the body. Or it could be confirmation of what's being spoken. It could be a lot of different things. But it doesn't mean that it's always for everybody. What we get tied up in is traditionally people in these type of circles think if they get something, it's got to be for everybody. Well, it's not true. God's an individual God. Yes, it may be, but when you go through the proper channels, then I read, somebody's given words before and I've read it, I thought, you know, that's really good. That's really encouraging. And so I have them come up and share it. And so anyway, so the prophecy. And then, let me just remind you, in 1 Corinthians 14:31, it says, all can prophesy one by one. And then the next one is tongues. Tongues is this, a message from God in a language unknown to the person through whom the message comes. I want to show you the clarity between this gift that comes sometimes and a prayer language which should stay with you all the time. There is the language of tongues. It's your prayer language to God. It also brings believers into unity together, but it is not what he's talking about right here. He's talking about sometimes there is a gift of tongues and someone gives it, but if a tongue is ever given publicly in service, there must be an interpretation. Otherwise, it leaves people confused, and God is not a God of confusion. He's just not. And, you know, something else about tongues. You know, in prayer this morning, pre-service prayer, man, we got in there, man, we were rip-roaring it up in tongues. Man, it was awesome. I love it when we were praying together and we were praying for the service today, the service flow would go well. We spoke out in our known language a subject to God that we wanted to pray about together. Then we began to pray in tongues together in unity. Well, we're all praying by the same Spirit. Therefore, we pray in unity. But there were no unbelievers or uninformed in the room. These two words mean a lot to me. Because over the years that we've been here, we've never really had a tongues and interpretation of tongues in public service. And I've had people, you know, say, well, why hasn't that happened? Well, I don't know. Maybe we're not ready. Could it be that? Could be we're a young church and we're just not ready. Now, if it's of the Lord, I don't want to stop it because I don't want to be scared that other people are going to be scared and leave either. But here's the truth of it, and we'll talk about more or less next week. Praying together in the Holy Spirit, everybody just rip-roaring in the Holy Spirit on a Sunday morning service, Paul says, that's not the way to do things because there may be unbelievers in the room and they're just going to get confused. And then he talks about tongues and interpretation, that if there's tongues and there's no interpretation, then the person shouldn't have spoke up. Now, could it be that it was right and the person had the interpretation didn't give it? It's possible. But I'm going to tell you, everything that I see about public service and the workings and manifestations of the Holy Spirit should always edify, always encourage, always lift up. Amen. Prophecy is to encourage, exhort, help bring direction. Prophecy is not for correction. It's not for calling out somebody's faults and stuff like that. You won't find it. So therefore, it seems to me that if a word comes in tongues, that the interpretation should match what a word of prophecy should be: exhortation, encouragement, lifting up. Amen. Okay, and so that just makes sense to me. Okay? Now, tongues, and in 1 Corinthians 14, 16 through 19 and 23, those are my reference verses for what I just said. Okay, but I want to be clear. I'm not talking about prayer language here. And I tell people all often, I said prayer language, let me tell you what the gift of praying in tongues is. It's for you and God. Yes. It's mainly for you to edify yourself. Jude says, build yourself up in the most holy faith, praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit. I pray in, and this is what Paul was saying. He says, I pray in tongues more than all of you wrapped up together. But in a public service, I'd rather say five words in English that mean something to somebody. The scripture is really clear about this stuff. But, you know, when I'm getting ready in the morning, I'll pray in the Spirit. When I'm driving down the road, I'll pray in the Spirit. When, you know, sometimes when I'm in worship, as long as it's not distracting anybody around me, I begin to praise in the Holy Spirit. Sometimes when Amy's led, she'll praise in it. But, you know, and there's another thing I didn't say last service. Sometimes we can't get so pigeonholed on how an interpretation has to come. Sometimes I'm praying in the Spirit, or we've prayed in the Spirit, and we didn't get an interpretation in corporate prayer, but the interpretation comes in a prophetic word during a song, or a spontaneous, which was a lot of this morning. And I believe, actually, the David thing, I was praying into something, and so when Amy started talking about some of that, it was actually an interpretation, but I hadn't given a public tongue. So God can still move. We got to realize we can't put him in a box. We have to allow him to move as he sees fit. Okay, I got to move on. So then interpretation of tongues. And interpretation of tongues is this. It's understanding and expressing the thought and intent of the message in tongues. Now, in 1 Corinthians 14, 5, he says, I wish you all spoke in tongues, but you need to interpret. Interpretation is a point where people have found to say the tongues is not right because it did not, the tongues lasted 2 minutes and the interpretation was 30 seconds. So it can't be right. Well, I want to tell you, it's an interpretation, not a translation. When in the UN, they have translators for all the different countries. They want to know word for word what was said. They want to know word for word. They want to know how many times bomb came up in the conversation, whose name was with it, and everything so that they can look at it. But we're not talking about translation. We're talking about interpretation, the thoughts and intents of the heart. And so when somebody gets a word in tongues, we pick it up in the spirit realm, and then we'll give the interpretation in English. And it could have been a long message in tongues, but it was simply the Lord saying, stand at this time, don't move back. If you think that you're not supposed to, if you feel like you're moving back, you're losing ground, don't worry about it. You're in place. You're right where you're supposed to be. And it might not be for everybody could use that, but it may be some two or three or four or five people in the audience needed that word. Okay? And then sometimes the tongues is short and the interpretation is longer. Now, I will tell you this. I've been in more than one service where I knew that they left the interpretation 5 minutes ago. There was a tongue, and it was good. It wasn't too long, it wasn't too short. But when Aunt Sally got up to give the interpretation, I mean, she went on and on. It went from interpretation to speaking, to preaching. And that's not right either. More about that next week. Okay, so, and then the last one is, you got to remember this. Interpretation sometimes has to do with the cultural differences. You know, if I go over to Romania, it may take more words to explain something. Yeah. You know, when I go over there, I have an interpreter. What are they doing? They're not translating, they're interpreting the thoughts and intents of my heart. That's why when you work with an interpreter, It's good to spend time together, to get to know each other. I've got one in Romania. We work really, really well together, but we didn't in the beginning, but we do now. Okay, the last three gifts, and we're almost done. Dynamic, or the power gifts. Here they are. This is the gifts of faith, the supernatural impartation of belief and confidence for a specific situation. You see somebody sick, you say, Holy Spirit, I'm going to pray for them. I want to be used of you. Give me the gift of healing. Now, you can ask for that, but I want to tell you something else. Don't just rely on the gifts to step out in faith and see people healed. Because there's two different ways. There's one, you heal by anointing, which I believe this is, and there's another one, you heal by authority because of the word. It says, he said the word was sent to heal them. So there's authority too, for another time. Daniel in the lion's den, that was a really good one. What? He had the gift, he had faith words that he wouldn't be eaten. And so he relied on those faith words in that situation. There's gifts of healing. These are supernatural endowments of divine health. And this is, you know, I talked about this already. People say, well, I have the gift of healing, or I have this, or I have that. What's the motive of why you're saying that? You know, anytime healing, miracles, prosperity, prophecy, words of knowledge, anytime any of these gifts draw attention to you instead of Holy Spirit, something's off. The attention should never go to you. It should always go to Holy Spirit. Now, granted, you're the one saying it. You're the one being used, okay? But, you know, you also have, the proverb says, man, the trial of a man is tested by the praise he receives. A man's heart is tried by the praise that he receives. And I heard Bill Johnson say this, if you don't live by the praises of people, you won't die by their criticism. And so when people say something, man, that was really awesome, or this, I praise God, man, I'm glad it ministered to you. I receive it. But always, 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 as I'm walking away or at the end of the day, I'm like, God, I know that was you. Amy and I had something recently come up. We have an opportunity to do something. And sometimes God will give you things that are so big. I don't know. I was actually flabbergasted by this thing. And I'll tell more about it later. But I knew as I read through this thing, it was about speaking somewhere. I knew, oh my God, I'm not good enough. Because of the amount of people that were going to be at this thing and where it was and all kinds of different things. There's tests for good things too. Well, either God's big enough in me or he's not. And I can't limit myself by my own ideals about myself. I've got to allow God to identify through me with people. And it's also, you know, it was really curious because it was a time when a good thing actually revealed your insecurities about yourself. You know? Yeah. People are just looking at me. I'm going to have to speak to like 1,100 people. I've never done that before. Now, I've done it over a four-week period of time with most of you week after week. But it's, you know, not together all in one time. Well, that can be a little bit startling. I won't say intimidating because I won't be intimidated. But so you have to believe that what I'm talking about right here, that the charis, the charisma of God will come upon you as needed. Okay? And so he'll give me the faith that I need to minister well in that environment. Okay? Otherwise, the Lord wouldn't have brought it. Okay, then there's the last one is the working of miracles. This is divine intervention that alters our natural circumstances. I love this one. And God is immutable, and if he did miracles in the Old Testament, he'll do miracles today. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's not out of the miracle business. And don't listen, I've listened to some motivational speaking. I've listened to some speaking about how your thoughts can produce things and all this kind of stuff. And one person actually, I think it's Napoleon Hill actually, says that a miracle is actually becoming aware of things coming into divine order and coming about that way. Listen, anything that happens supernaturally and alters current circumstances is a miracle and means God's involved. We cannot allow God to be explained a way out of things. He is the miracle bringer. He is the miracle doer. Okay.